It's time for another edition of Live from Studio M on 105.5 Triple M. I'm your host, Jonathan Suttin. No fear. We've heard that slogan before. I believe it's the name of a sportswear company, too. However, most of us have a little fear when it comes to trying new things. Not this artist. She grew up in a small town in Illinois, but headed west as soon as she could. After college, she moved out to LA to get a record deal and got it almost immediately. We'll talk to her about her adventures, maybe get her to sing a song from the musical Annie, and we'll find out what it's like to play a celebrity wedding. But first, let's hear a song from Lissie, live from Studio M. Studio M, our guest today, Lissie. And man, I never want to get in a fight with you, although I think I'd want to take you to a sporting event. That voice, my goodness, what luck. You just such power. Is it you kind of always had that gift?
I've always been pretty loud, yeah. Since I was really small, I liked singing, and my friends will say, like, anytime we're out, like, even if I'm in a different room, even my speaking voice, like, they're just like, we can hear you. And everything that you're saying, by the way, so don't, like, say anything you don't want everyone to hear, because you have this, like, frequency that just slices through all other conversation. Yeah, I don't know. I just, my grandfather was a singer. I have a lot of singing in my family, so I guess I just always had a big voice, yeah.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic. And growing up, so Rock Island, right?
Rock Island, Illinois.
Okay, so I didn't know a whole lot about Rock Island, but then I looked up and it said it has the largest government-owned weapons manufacturing arsenal in the U.S.
Yes,
so,
that's the Arsenal Island.
Okay, so does everybody work there pretty much? Or?
It's a big employer. You know, John Deere is also based next to Rock Island in Moline. Okay. So a lot of like farm-related and stuff. And yes, the Arsenal is a large employer. It is weird to think of all these weapons that are made in the town I'm from, where they must go and end up and what they do. But there was a country club actually on the Arsenal Island too. That's where I like learned to swim.
Really? It's
like right next to where they make the weapons. So it's kind of bizarre.
Yeah.
But it's a great place with a lot of history. The Rock Island Line and steamboats. Abraham Lincoln actually defended a case there back in the day. So there's a lot of history.
So there's a lot to it.
Yeah.
In your own history there, not to bring up bad things, but in high school, you kind of, the only thing I read was you like kind of had, you and the choir teacher kind of had a situation. And
I mean,
not to go back to all that, but... Yeah.
It's a long story. It's a very long story, which like I cannot tell in under an hour whenever I attempt to.
Okay.
I did something that was pretty inexcusable, but someone made me feel, and I'd been made to feel a lot in high school, that I didn't have a voice and what I had to say wasn't important, and I just snapped, and then I got kicked out of high school and arrested and had to go to jail for like a couple of hours.
Really?
It was like they kind of made an example out of me sort of
thing. Oh, wow.
It wasn't like violent, but... Anyway, so it's not a
problem. But you say it with a smile, so it seems
yeah, well,
okay, you know?
I mean, I was talking to my grandma the other day, because I was really worried about how my family would be disappointed in me, and I'd written her a letter, and she said, you know, I really appreciated that letter, but I also think it's, you know, it's not good to it's not good that you did what you did, but also, like, you have to stick up for yourself, or no one else will. So I've always kind of had that, like, kind of feisty.
Right.
I'm very sweet, but if you... mess with me.
Yeah,
I will.
Exactly.
I will. I can hold my own. So
yeah,
yeah.
Yeah. So then, have you ever seen that choir teacher again, or they know
your
success?
No, it was a band director,
okay.
But it was sort of because something with the choir teacher, a miscommunication. She had failed me in my freshman year. She never liked me.
Uh-huh.
But sadly, she's passed away. I never saw her again.
Okay.
But I did see the guy, the band director again. I mean, you have to know the backstory. And we had a good conversation, and we apologized to one another.
Okay.
And, you know, it's all good now. So,
okay.
But it is a part of my story. You know,
right.
I need to write a book about it. It's a really long, winding tale.
Right. Oh, I'm sure. But so then you did finish up high school, and then you went off to college out west.
Yeah.
And you were in Colorado, right?
Yeah, Colorado State.
Yeah.
I was there for 2 years. I did a semester abroad in Paris, and then I actually dropped out of college,
right.
So I didn't finish.
And so the semester, see, I always regretted that I didn't do a semester abroad, because everyone I know, it seems like it transforms their life, and it kind of did for you, didn't it, going to Paris?
I think, because I grew up in, you know, somewhat of like a, you know, just in the middle of the country, and my siblings had gone off to good colleges, and so I traveled a little bit, but I was still pretty, fairly naive, so I think it gave me the confidence to decide to move to LA, that like here I was 20 and I was like finding my way around Paris, and I didn't, that was before like GPS in your phone. I didn't have a phone when I was there, and I think it gave me some confidence, like if you can like go to a foreign country and make your way around and find stuff and get things going for yourself. I played gigs over there. Then I thought, well, if you can do that, then you can, you know,
LA's easy then.
Then LA's easy, yeah.
Okay, we'll talk more about the adventures of that, but we'd love to hear another song. What are you going to do
first?
Yeah,
well, I have a few. Do you want me to do the one that
we
you
can
requested?
Say that. We can
save that one?
We'll say that.
Okay, well, I'll do a song about the town I left when I moved back to the Midwest this summer. I left a town called Ojai, California.
Beautiful. It's Lissie live from Studio One.
Believing in my
that I made up my mind so good. I know I'm gonna see you again. And I'll be thinking of you until then.
Date a guy named Eli and then you break up with him, you can maybe make it as a breakup song.
Yeah, well, I sometimes think maybe I shouldn't tell people that it's about a town called Ojai, even though it's spelled O-J-A-I on the song, but,
right.
You know, it could kind of be clever, like, oh, hi, you know, so where it's not about a town, it could be about, like,
yeah.
You know, a relationship.
For sure.
Two people who care about each other but have to part, I don't know.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. Apply.
So you, when you did move out to L.A., you did just, like, just sort of like, I'm going to get a record deal. Like, you didn't know any better? Is that really true? You just kind of, like, went out there? And...
Well, kind of. I mean, I went to... So, I think because growing up, like, if you see in the movies, like, you have... If you want to get a record deal, you move to L.A.
Right.
I don't know. Like,
right.
I wasn't very realistic. I just sort of was, like, blindly confident. So, I went to a school called the Musicians Institute, which was, like, a six-month program. Sort of more to have, like, I mean, my mom, it was her idea, because she wanted to know that I was showing up every day somewhere, and people knew who I was and that I existed if
right.
I, like, disappeared or something, you know. So I did study some, like, basic recording skills and things there, and that gave me, like, a bit of a foundation to have some friends, and but I didn't really know anyone at all. I found a place just on, you know, what, Craigslist or something, Westside Rentals. Anyway, so yeah, it is true. I just didn't know any better. I think I thought, well, I'm just gonna go play my guitar around town, and someone's gonna discover me.
And that's what happened.
And it did happen. It's a longer story than that. You know, recently I was on Norwegian Idol, and they the kids were asking me questions all about, like, success and how does it happen. And it's like, it's a very long process with ups and downs, and there's always more to do. So I think, you know, I got a deal, but then I got dropped, and then I got another deal, but then I didn't make an album for like 2 years, and then, you know, so it's not as, like, sudden as it sounds, but I did,
but
at least get my foot in the door. Yes.
Yeah. Norwegian Idol, by the way, I guess. Is there a meme, like, is it the same setup? Is there a dorky Paula and everything, like, what?
No, you know, I only went in and taped my part, and I briefly met the judges. I don't know culturally that's the same as it would be here, if it would be maybe as, you know, mean-spirited or something.
Right.
You know, I think they probably make some jokes, and there's a tough guy. I don't know. It's in Norwegian, so...
Was that your agent figured that out, or because you're blonde, or
No, I do quite well in Norway. I have the kind of markets in Europe where I have a really great fan base. So I'm just kind of a
big deal in Norway. Yeah.
I guess you could say so. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to sound arrogant to saying that I'm big in Norway, but they're just lovely people, and they welcome me, and they come to my shows, and I spend.
So,
a lot of time
but what
there.
About the language situation there? They
speak really good English.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah,
and
sure.
I speak no Norwegian.
all right, so before we get another song, you did Ojai. You didn't live in L.A. You kind of moved away, right?
I spent 5 years in Hollywood,
mm-hmm.
and it was a really fun time. But, I mean, it's a really inspiring yet cruel place, and it's intense. So I kind of stayed there as long as I needed to secure, like, my team and my situation. And then I found a place an hour and a half north of L.A. called Ojai, which... you know, was kind of the small
town that was very sleepy and quiet and pretty and lots of nature, which is more my
your
style,
speed, yeah.
My speed. Yeah, so I spent the last 6-7 years in Ojai, and it was hard to leave, but I just moved back to Iowa.
Right, and yeah. We could talk more about the farm and stuff and beehives that you
okay.
that you potentially have. But you, well, there's, you see, there's so many things to talk about with you, but I want to hear. So why don't
I'm very long-winded, so you can't get any short answers out of me.
Why don't we, the song that you did for your aunt, though, why don't we talk about that and you play that song?
Yeah,
that
sounds good.
So do you want to tell us a little bit?
Yeah, so my Aunt Laura, that's my mom's sister, grew up very close to her, and her daughters, my cousins, I'm very close with, and she got ALS in like 2007 or 8. It took a while for them to know what it was, and she ended up passing away from ALS in 2010, and it was just such a shock and such a tragedy. It's a disease that doesn't have a known cause or cure, and it's just an awful, terrible, terrible thing that I would hope no one would ever have to go through as a patient or a family, as a loved one. So, you know, I write songs about the things that I feel, and that sort of helps me process my emotions. And it took me, you know, a good 5 years to be able to write a song about her and how I think about her every day. It's like, it never ceases to like surprise me that she is not, it's like, I feel like, oh yeah, she's not here. Like, I think I just don't see her because I don't live at home. But she's gone, and it sucks. And I know a lot of people have experienced loss, and you can't do anything about it other than hope that, you know, wherever they are, they can feel your love. And, you know, it's a heavy topic. I've played this song enough now that I don't always burst into tears when I play it. But,
Sun
yes.
Keeps Rising? Is that
Sun Keeps Rising, okay. And it's for my Aunt Laura. Sun Keeps
Lissie,
Rising.
Lissie, live from Studio R.
Every day, I hope that you're okay. Anyway, you're in a better place. That's what they say.
Let's lighten it up now, shall we? When Jay Leno was still running The Tonight Show, you were a guest, and I saw a story that it said that your drummer or bass player like photobombed Mitt Romney or something.
Yeah.
Or what's that story? I'm just curious.
Not on purpose. Just Ann Romney was on talking about her cookbook, and she had something called Mitloaf that she was making.
Okay.
And so he came out and surprised her. While she was making, not really, but like surprised the audience while
right.
she was making Mitloaf. And then at the end of the show, like after we played, we were still in the background and Ann and Mitt were like in the front. And they seemed like really lovely, nice people. And he watched our sound check and stuff and was said hello. But anyway, so it's like the two of them and my bass player's friend had been at home and took a picture like of him on the screen. And when she sent it, it's like right between Ann and Mitt. It's like just his like head was sort of little, like right between their necks in the background. And it was just like such a funny, awesome picture of him, like kind of just right there wedged between the Romneys. So I had to Instagram that.
Yeah, that's good. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
So doing a gig like that, a lot of musicians who come to visit us sometimes have different experiences on doing those kind of things where they feel like they waited around forever and then it ended quickly or it weren't really. I don't know, what was the experience like for you doing that kind of gig?
You know, I mean, any kind of, like, even this kind of thing. I mean, I don't think I'm really ever as good as I am at night when I'm playing a concert, like, to my fan base.
Right.
Also, just because your voice has more time to warm up. But I don't know, it's a little nerve-wracking. It never really goes as well as you want it to, I feel like. But it's such a good opportunity to get out there and be seen. And just, like, cool, like, you know, when I was on Leno, like, all my friends went to this bar and like watched it and thought that was pretty cool, you know, so gives you some bragging rights.
For sure, for sure.
Yeah.
And is it true that, although they're no longer together, that you were at Ashton Kutcher and Demi Moore's wedding playing or something? Or what was that, or crashing? Or
no, it was very, very high, like under wraps. I actually signed like a confidentiality thing, so I mean, not that I'd have anything to tell you, but I can tell you that I was at the time signed to Maverick Records by Guy Osiri, who manages like Madonna and Lenny Kravitz and all these people, and U2 now. And he was the one that signed me. And so initially he was taking me around to all these like crazy star-studded things like to sort of get me in the mix. And I was so shy and nervous in that setting. Anyway, so he just told me I was singing at an event and like to just kind of wear a dress or look kind of nice, that it was a fancy event. And to learn some love songs, and I told him which ones I was going to do, and then
What were you doing, like standard ones?
I did a version of Lauryn Hill's Tell Him,
okay,
which is a beautiful song, and then At Last, which is just sort of classic romance song, and then I went to his house, and then like we went to another house, and we got picked up by another car, and went to like another house.
And then you were blindfolded.
And then, yeah, it was one of those things where it's like, because there were, you know, the paparazzi are nuts, like if they got wind that anything was going down,
right,
they would have, you know, Ben like had a helicopter over the house. So ended up going to this really nice house and walking in and still like, I have no clue what I'm here for. And I was like, okay, well, Demi and Ashton are getting married and you're singing during their ceremony. Like the actual, like not like afterwards, like as a performer, but like I was part of their, I mean, it was an honor just for anyone, not just because they're famous, to get to be a part of someone's,
sure,
you know, wedding that you don't really know. Like, and so I sang while they like walked down the aisle and did their whole thing, and as they were coming back out, and everyone was really nice to me, but again, I was so shy, so I just sort of kept to myself, because that wasn't a normal environment for me to be in.
Not for most of us, it wouldn't be, yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, so it was a cool thing to do. And
so do you think if you would have known ahead of, that's maybe the best way to do it, I think. If you would have known ahead of time, don't you think it would have freaked you out more? Or not necessarily?
Yeah, probably so. I think I would have had more time to consider like all the possible things that could go wrong or something.
Right.
So yeah, I think it was fine how it worked out. And they were, you know, I don't talk to them now, but for a few years afterwards, they'd invite me to like birthday parties and things and,
cool,
you know, keep me in there, you know, as someone who'd been part of a special moment in their life. So
yeah. So then, like afterwards, did you get to like mingle?
Well, I did, but I didn't mingle. I'm very talkative, obviously. Yeah. I kind of think I'm just really open and like not mysterious and sort of dorky. And I know everyone's always like, oh, I'm such a dork, but it's really true in my case. I am. And I think the way I came across, like even when I was in LA, was like, people would just be like, oh my gosh, like, why are you just like talking at me? Like, you know, like, why aren't you acting cool? I just don't know. I just didn't know how to be cool. And I was aware of it. So you just
shut up. You just kept it. Okay.
I just sort of was like, oh, hi, thanks. And ate some dinner and like had a glass of wine and then just sort of went home.
Because there were a lot of cool people there, right?
It was pretty small. It wasn't like what you're expecting. It was just like a very intimate thing. Okay. There was like a handful of famous people there, but you know, it wasn't like a wild star-studded thing. I had been taken to some other star-studded parties where, again, I just was so shy. It's like, oh, there's Lionel Richie and Madonna. And
you wouldn't talk to them, or you?
No. I didn't. It's like, oh, the Red Hot Chili Peppers are there, and Matthew McConaughey. I mean, it was like, I was the only non-famous person there. And I never really tell these stories, so it's funny I'm talking about it, because nothing like came out of it aside from me just like sitting quietly in a corner,
Freaked out, observing it.
Yeah. Okay, so cool.
And I mentioned in the open about Annie. That was because that was like one of your first gigs. You were the lead in Annie, right, in school?
Yeah, not in school actually. There's a professional dinner theater in Rock Island called Circuit 21. And when I was 9, I was Annie, and I did 82 shows. And it was hardcore. I did like six or six, we did a matinee every Wednesday. I think we only had Sundays off. And
it's
I was
a sweatshop, right?
Yeah, I was also going to school, and I got paid a little bit for it. And so it was like my first pro gig.
Yeah,
but I loved it. I loved being on stage. I loved performing. I think I really realized, like, you know, I don't necessarily like, love attention or, you know, but I just love to perform. And I mean, I still do. It's why I will travel, like, for a billion hours in the most annoying circumstances just to get on stage for like 60 minutes, you know, just
or even 30 like you did today.
yeah.
So finally, last thing, and we'll have time for one more song. So now you live in Iowa, right? So you have a farm in Iowa, or?
So I'm on the road like all the time, so
okay.
I don't really live anywhere currently.
Okay.
I bought a 10-acre farm in northeastern Iowa.
Okay.
And that was something I've wanted to do my whole life, because just, you know, I grew up on the Illinois side of the river, but I've just always really loved Iowa. I think it's really beautiful, and I used to go canoeing in northeast Iowa, and da da da. So it's always something I wanted to do. Earlier this year, I was actually just not going to make an album. I wanted a break. I wanted to be back closer to my family. So I'm like, oh, I'm going to buy this farm in Iowa. And I went and looked at properties, and I found a really beautiful place. And I'm fixing up the house currently. So I won't really move in until probably May when I get off the road, which I'm looking forward to, like planting some trees and.
Right.
So I really like the outdoors. So having like my own, and I'm trying to get more acreage connected to mine. So I just like the idea of like having like 50 acres that are mine, and growing, not necessarily not doing conventional farming or even farming, just like having my land be like the land that gets to sort of take a break and just do wildflowers and
cool.
Be a friend to the pollinators and.
Nice.
It's a long process ahead.
Yeah. And so you got your dog Byron, and then is that...
Byron's been up there a few times. He doesn't know what to make of it, but he's mostly, like, stays with family when I'm gone. Sad. I don't get to... Tomorrow's his birthday. He's going to be 10. But...
It's my son's birthday. He's going to be 1.
Oh,
I'll always know that Byron has the same birthday.
So
they can have a party together. Okay.
Yes.
We do have time for one more. What do you want to finish?
I'm going to do what's the single. I have an album coming out February 12th. It's called My Wild West, and this is like the single off of it. It's called Don't You Give Up On Me.
You set the sun, I feel your way.